Thanks for staying up later. Very happy to have Ron Howard with us for the next couple of nights. We hope the two shows is enough to cover all the areas, television, acting, and directing. Let's start, though, with an acting role of yours. You were in the last film John Wayne ever made.
Oh, yeah, that's right, The Shootist. I think it was made in 1976, and I just turned 21 on that movie, and he used to call me Old 21. We were actually filming in Carson City, Nevada, part of it. So that's how I really knew I was 21, because one day I couldn't be in the casino, and the next day I could.
He played this old gunfighter.
That's right.
The Shootist, and in fact gets killed at the end. And other than the Alamo and this, and maybe a couple other, he didn't bite the dust too often on film.
No, he didn't, and this turned out to be his last film, and so that was somewhat ironic. No one really talked about that as we were making the movie, and he certainly, you know, in his mind and heart had more movies in him, and wanted to make those.
Did that make him a little irascible on the set?
Well, he was kind of an irascible guy. I mean, I didn't know exactly what to expect going into this movie. I was a John Wayne fan in that I'm kind of a movie fan, you know, but not. I wasn't particularly in awe of him, and I gained a lot of respect for him as we were working on the movie. Not in the greatest of health, but really working hard. And one of the reasons that he and I got along real well is that everybody else was a little bit intimidated, but we had a lot of important scenes together, and I liked to rehearse, and I saw very early that he liked to rehearse. So I was sort of one of the only actors to go up and say, "Hey, you want to run the lines?" And he'd say, "Well, sure." And we'd go in and we'd work on them, and I saw there how dedicated he was.
Pat Masterson told Cobb.
Pat Masterson.
Yeah. He says that a man has to have guts, deliberation, and a proficiency with firearms.
Did he mention that third eye you better have?
Third eye?
For that dumbass amateur. It's usually some six-fingered buster that couldn't hit a cow on a tit with a tin cup that does you in. But then Bat Masterson always was full of sheep dip.
And that's the lesson that you keep learning over and over again, is that people who last, probably in any field of endeavor, but certainly in the movies, you know, they last for a reason. Sure, they've got some gifts and charisma and so forth, but, you know, they work harder than anybody else.
Other than working hard at your craft, did he teach you anything, either directly or just by you observing him?
Well, he you were talking about him being a little irascible, and he knew how to throw his weight around a little bit on the set, and so I actually learned a lot from the director Don Siegel, because by then I already knew I wanted to direct. Mm-hmm. I was crazed about it since I was about 15 years old. So here are these two guys, both with great reputations. One, of course, is a major, major movie star. The other is an important Hollywood director, and they're butting heads all the time. I mean, it's not like fireworks are going off, but there was a lot of tension, and it was really interesting to see how Don Siegel would handle this dynamic, and also how John Wayne would, because they were both pros and they needed to get through the movie even though they weren't getting along. I thought that was pretty pretty interesting. He also, I asked him a lot of questions about John Ford. You know, mm-hmm. He, as an actor, he worked for John Ford on who knows how many times. John Ford started him as a property master, a prop man coming out of USC. He just hired him because he was a football player that he liked, and let him have a job, and, you know, one thing led to another. But he did say one thing that I thought was pretty interesting. He said that when it came to emotional moments, you know, sentimental moments in movies, shouldn't be afraid of them, but you should only take the emotion about two-thirds of the way there and then let the audience finish the emotion. And, you know, that's the way to really reach out and communicate and not overpower the audience. And I thought that was a bit of advice that I've tried to stick with.
Obvious irony in this film. He's diagnosed by a doctor played by Jimmy Stewart.
Right.
as having cancer. I mean, what a cast, as an aside here. Then he goes to a boarding house run by Lauren Bacall.
Right.
And then eventually, as he's shot, he kills Richard Boone and Hugh O'Brien.
That's right.
before he's eventually shot in the back.
Paladin and Wyatt Earp.
Right. Like, man, oh, man, this guy was one tough son of a gun. You may kill him, but he's taking everybody with him. he's diagnosed as having, and here I am laughing, he's diagnosed as having cancer. There's an upbeat topic. Right. But he had cancer himself at the time. And then in this, his last movie scene, he's shot in the back,
right.
And you wind up first avenging his death,
right.
And then covering his body.
Well, it was, it was kind of eerie. Ironically enough, that last sequence, that shootout sequence, because it was very physically demanding and complicated, it was saved for the last. And before we got to that sequence, John Wayne got sick. And the word was that it was the flu. And everybody just kind of accepted that for the first few days. And then as it got to be a week, 10 days, I know there was a little buzz that, you know, maybe he wasn't going to be able to make it back to finish the movie. And it was, for me, you know, it was great when he showed up and did it, but there's no question that I was thinking a lot about making that connection.
Look out!
Somebody tried to talk about it on the set once. He got really angry about it. He said, "This is a movie," yeah. and I ain't dying, basically. And he healed up and he did the movie. And I saw him 6 months later, and he said, "Hey kid, I got a book here. I think it's a movie, and it's you and me, or it's nobody." I was all set to go, and you know, but unfortunately, Shootist was the last film.
So he never lost his passion for it. He wanted to do it.
He loved it. He loved it. I also had a chance to work on a TV series, a terrible TV series called The Smith Family, with Henry. Don't worry if you didn't see it.
No, I actually remember it because it came on the air my freshman year in college, and I remember seeing it a few times, and there were these heavy-handed attempts at addressing the generation gap.
Oh, yeah,
and it was a sad situation.
Well, that was my job. You know, my hair was supposed to... And, of course, they picked the wrong guy for, like, hipness anyway, right? I grew my hair a little long and tried, but it wasn't much of a show. Best known for the dopiest theme song ever. But anyway, the...
That was that Primrose Lane theme song. Why do I know these things?
Because you made fun of it, that. I know you did. everyone, so did we. Anyway, the... both with Fonda and then later with John Wayne, I found that both of those guys had always wished they'd done more directing. John Wayne did direct one movie. Fonda never directed on film. And they both knew I was interested because I used to yap on and on about this directing thing. I mean, I must have just bored everybody. So they couldn't help but hear about that. But they both told me that they had it to do all over again. They would have been film directors rather than movie stars. They just felt it was, you know, in the end, no matter how much power you might have as a star at any one given time, ultimately it's a director's medium, and that's really where the fun is.
So I have to ask the obvious question. What was the best bit of advice that Fonda gave you?
he once explained to me how you could do like an eating scene 45 times without messing up your dialogue and getting the food in the way, and having the script supervisor say, "No, you lifted your fork on the word coming instead of going." And he had a little system. I never saw anything like it. He was a very methodical man, and we had this huge long breakfast scene, and he went over first thing in the morning. It was one of the first scenes I'd done with him, and I'd always been just kind of haphazard about this kind of thing. Yeah. Been tormented by the person who's supposed to tell me when I'm taking what. I'd be stuffing food in, and you know, and having to do it over again because nothing matched, and you know, you couldn't hear my lines or anything. He went over to the script supervisor and the property guy, and he said, "Now, I'm going to need 3 grapefruit segments." Then, then he turned to the script supervisor and he said, "On the word they, I'm going to eat one. On the word police force, I'm going to eat another one. And then right at the end of the scene, I'm going to pop that last one in." And he'd sorted that out, and he did it, and that's the way he did it. And we did it all day long, and he never had one problem with it. And I thought, well, that's interesting. Technique.
Primrose Lane. Life's a holiday on Primrose Lane.
Go on, Lincoln. Do like your brother. Fly. Please fly. Go on, Lincoln. Follow him. Hurry. They're okay, Pa. They all flew off okay. Guess I did a good job, huh, Pa?
You sure did, son.
I read somewhere where Andy Griffith made a comment about you when you were just a little kid playing Opie Taylor, and apparently there was a touching scene in one of these Andy Griffith shows, and you had to cry.
Right.
And you imagined a dog of yours dying that made you sad.
Gulliver. Gulliver the dog.
Your dog,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And that caused you to weep. And his comment was, Ron Howard was practicing the method whether he knew it or not.
Father's an actor, Rance Howard, a character actor, he'd been acting for 10 years before I was born, I realized later that he actually was giving me the fundamentals, real good strong acting fundamentals as a little kid. I remember doing a show live, and it was a episode of the Red Skelton Show. Here's this kind of goofy show where I'm in there and he's playing the, you know, Freddy the Freeloader, the clown and everything. And I had just turned 5 years old, but I'll never forget this. Right before we're going on my father took me aside and he said, "Now," he said, "really look at him when he's talking to you and just listen. Just listen to what he's saying. And you'll know when it's time to say your lines. You know your lines. Don't worry about that. Just really look at him and listen." I think that one of the reasons that both my brother Clint and I have kind of survived to have adult careers and to continue to grow with the business is that as kids we weren't taught. Look, I've directed kids and it's very difficult. It's very difficult sometimes when you're looking for a specific result to not frankly kind of treat them like trained animals. You know, it's like, stand here, look cute. We make some noises off on the side and we'll get a great reaction and somehow it'll work. But that's not teaching the child how to act. And my father did a great job of really teaching us how to act. And it paid off later as we were going through other phases of our lives because we'd learned something. We'd learned a craft.
An interesting story I read is about your father going through scenes of Mr. Roberts with you to teach you to act.
Yeah.
And he's Mr. Roberts and you're Ensign Pulver. And the key is you're 5.
Right. I was even younger when he started doing that. He was He had traveled in the road production of Mr. Roberts with the Henry Fonda production and also with John Forsythe. And so he knew that play inside out, and he had directed it a lot in summer stock and things like that. And I used to sit around and watch it. And so I think one of the earliest indications that my parents had that I was interested or had some aptitude was I started mimicking the dialogue. And we did this scene, and I played the part that Jack Lemmon plays in the movie.
And a little kid who won't blow lines is invaluable in television or film.
Well, that's really how I got going, is I somehow fell into a couple of live TV shows early on. And at age 4 or 5, the fact that I didn't blow my lines and it was live and it all worked out, suddenly I was really in demand. And I did a lot of shows before I started the Andy Griffith Show, like, 5 or 6 episodes of Dennis the Menace, or I did a Twilight Zone episode, and Dobie Gillis, and shows like that.
You know? And it occurs to me that we'll never see you on a panel on Oprah or Geraldo about child TV stars of the 50s and 60s who wind up desperately depressed, totally alienated, hating the experience. I mean, yours came out happy, right?
Mine did. You know, my kids aren't in the business now. I don't have them in it. You know, I mean, if they want to pursue it as adults, they can. It's really challenging. My brother Clint has survived it. He hasn't had the kind of luck that I've had, but he loves it. He loves to act, and he's got something that he enjoys and believes in, and he can make a living with. But you go through adolescence. I mean, anybody gets a little bit screwed up. Everybody struggles, and it's a time in your life when you don't want to be noticed particularly by anybody. You want to try to fit in, and if you've been an actor, a child actor, you don't fit in. Fact is, everybody notices you, and kids, you know, can be kind of cruel at that age, and so it's a particular kind of challenge. Now, I think that can be offset if you have this other life away from that, and that is, you know, on a TV show or working in movies, and that's going well. But when that goes away, and suddenly you're going out on auditions, and you're not getting the parts, and you can't quite figure out why, and you got zits, and you're feeling pretty crummy about yourself in general, and people are making fun of you maybe at school. I think it can heighten basically what all of us feel when we go through that very sensitive time in our lives. And I think it can be dangerous. It's a risky thing. It's not to be entered into lightly when people put their kids into the business.
12.
I came across a Time magazine article on you from about 1963. You were 9 years old,
right?
And here's the quote. What do you want to be when you grow up? Now, most kids say a baseball player, a fireman, a policeman.
Right.
You say an actor, a writer, a producer, a director, a cameraman. You're 9 years old.
All right. A couple of years later, I added baseball player to that list. I thought I could be sort of a seasonal thing, you know. But,
right. Utility man.
Yeah. Curveballs did me in, like a lot of others. I loved it. You know, I mean, a lot of kids get into this business, and, you know, there are all kinds of horror stories. I think I was fortunate, not only in the way that my parents handled it, my development, you know, making it a real learning experience and a growing one, but the environment on the Andy Griffith Show set, as corny as it sounds, it was really kind of idyllic. It was and fun, and I just loved it. I also loved the experience of being involved, you know, in a creative endeavor. And as a little kid, I was allowed to actually participate, to make suggestions. And,
uh-huh.
You know, they'd get shot down most of the time. But I was in there pitching, you know.
Sheldon Leonard was on the show, and he told us that your dad was very insistent that this be as close to normal as possible.
Yeah.
Your friends could come on the set. You could socialize and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
But that you often used your free time of your own accord to ask questions, to sit on the cameraman's shoulders and look through the lens and, right. to familiarize yourself with what was going on. That was your choice.
Well, I had three things that I had to do besides, you know, show up and do my acting job. One is I had to go to school there, and I had a great teacher for the whole time, Catherine Barton. The other thing was I got a hoop, so I was always doing foul, you know, no matter how crowded it got, somehow I could always find get 15 feet away and practice foul shots. The other thing was hang out with the crew. And it didn't take me long to realize that it was really a fascinating process, and that the people were great. I liked mm-hmm. spending time with the camera crew, but I also loved hanging around with the actors. I mean, there was a lot of laughter on that show and a lot of joking, and it was fun to be there and interesting to, you know, to see the way the scenes would change and how people would come up with ideas. And before long, I realized that the director was the person who kind of got to hang out with everybody, and that job started to look good to me.
What's the most important difference between directing for television and for feature films, other than the obvious difference that you're going to have obviously a larger budget with a feature film. And the certain things you can and can't say on television. But in terms of craft, what's the biggest difference?
Well, the biggest, most important in television is the actors and the performance and what they have to say. And of course, that's important in films also. But it's a bigger screen, it's a longer story, it takes longer to unfold. You know, and the texture is so much more important. Things that you see in the details in the background, things that you feel, subtleties, the visual impact of the way you frame a shot is much more important in a feature film than it is in television, where primarily your main objective is to record what the actors are doing. And it's a more intimate kind of environment with TV. And that's a lesson that TV directors have to learn when they move into features.
To Ticketmaster or charge by phone today.
As promised, Ron Howard is back tomorrow night. Now, as we walk out of here and they roll the credits, you know, the people on the later show, Ron and I are going to pretend that we're going fishing, okay?
See you later. I was casting with my own hand.
Thanks for staying up later. This is night two with Ron Howard. We covered a lot of ground last night. I know we can't get everything that's left into half an hour, but we'll try. We didn't talk about American Graffiti, which was, you know, kind of a major generational film. What are your thoughts on it now with about 20 years worth of perspective?
Well, I haven't seen it in a few years, but it was great to work on, I think it's one of George Lucas's best movies. I mean, everybody kind of remembers him for Star Wars and for producing Raiders, The Lost Ark, but it's amazing what he was able to do with that film, and it was shot very quickly, and it was a very low budget movie, but a great cast. You know, Richard Dreyfuss and Cindy Williams and Charlie Martin Smith. Suzanne Summer, you know, a lot of people who showed up later. Harrison Ford, of course.
You were, as I recall, were Cindy Williams' boyfriend, and you had kind of broken up, and you're getting back together for one last night before you go to college the next day.
That was a wild experience for me. I had just graduated from high school, and suddenly we were filming all night, every night. So you, like, had to stay out. It was, if you weren't working, you had to find something to, you know, to kill the night with, because, you know, you had to stay in that pattern. So that was an amazing experience for me, and also completely different, because I'd come out of this world of highly organized television production mostly. You know, I'd done movies, but they were real Hollywood movies, very traditional kind of Hollywood movies. And suddenly I was with, you know, like people with beards making this movie, up in San Francisco in 1972, you know. And
Might have had dinner once in Greenwich Village.
Yeah,
you never know.
it was kind of an alternative lifestyle kind of filmmaking experience. And it was great. And also to learn about the attention to detail that George Lucas was paying. And I think that's one of his great gifts. You know, he spent as much time trying to find the cars, just the right cars to be in that movie, as he did trying to find the right actors.
Come on, what are you talking about?
Well, I was thinking I could wait a year, you know, go to city for a while.
You chicken thing.
Oh, wait a minute. After all we went through to get accepted, we're finally getting out of this turkey town, and now you want to crawl back into your cell, right? You won't end up like John. You just can't stay 17 forever.
You know, if you see it now, on The Late Show or Rent It, you probably don't appreciate, because there were so many imitators mm-hmm. of that technique and that sensibility that you don't realize what an impact it had at the time.
Oh, it was
there hadn't been a major film that tapped into that emotion prior to that.
That's right. And it was also shot in that style and used the music in the way
right,
that
using
the music
that way was key.
You know, and even the multiple storylines. You know, that was kind of a revolutionary idea. And later I worked with that sort of format on Cocoon and Parenthood.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I learned about it from acting in American Graffiti.
Richard Dreyfuss told me he had no sense of how big this thing would be.
Oh,
in fact, he had misgivings about it. He didn't even think it was that good.
It was, nobody did. We would drive back from having shot all night. Haskell Wexler was the cinematographer, world-class cinematographer, but he really believed in George Lucas, so he was like doing him a favor.
Yeah.
Literally, he would fly in just to shoot at night and then go back and shoot other movies or commercials or things like that. So we'd be riding back to the hotel. The sun was up. We were sleepy. And we're saying, I don't know, is this movie even any good? Well, what's it going to do, you know? And Haskell said, you guys are all doing a great job, but it's designed to be one thing. Theater drive-in near you for 2 weeks and out. That's it. And we all said, yeah, that makes sense. And that's what we thought we were doing. And it hit a nerve. And I think that one of the things that George Lucas, as a filmmaker, has been able to do with, you know, as much or more consistency as anyone is give you movies that are completely different and that really that do kind of establish new trends. He's been able to make those kind of breakthroughs in the movies. They're entertaining, they're accessible, but you haven't seen anything like that, so you can't compare it to anything else.
Yeah. Since we do care for each other so much, and since we should really consider ourselves as adults now, could I have a couple of those fries?
Come on.
Where was I?
Consider ourselves adults.
Right. I thought maybe before I leave, we could agree that seeing other people while I'm away can't possibly hurt, you know?
You mean dating other people?
I think it would strengthen our relationship. Then we'd know for sure that we're really in love. Not that there's any doubt.
Do you think it's a coincidence that some of the most successful film directors at present came out of a television environment? Now, your situation is extreme because you were in it at such a young age and you were schooled by your father. But still, I'm thinking Danny DeVito, Louis De Palma, look at him.
Yeah.
Penny Marshall from Laverne and Shirley.
Right.
Rob Reiner, of course, your friend, the meathead from All in the Family.
Right.
Is this a coincidence or is there some tie-in?
I think that for a number of years, there was a kind of a division in Hollywood between those who did television and those who did movies. And and I also think that the studio executives didn't look to actors to particularly become directors. And there was more of a system in place. And it just started to break down in the 70s, thank God. And I think sensibilities changed in a way too. And I think that people who had come out of that television experience, actors who aspired to, you know, something more, working in a longer format and everything, but who really understood comedy, who understood entertainment, it was suddenly discovered that was a good training ground, an acceptable training ground, and it was pretty difficult to convince people of that when I was first trying to make that move. I was also very, very young, but nobody had really done that at that point. Some movie actors had directed with varying degrees of success, but it's worked out really well.
You had three pretty obvious things, and maybe more than three, but three that occur to me working against you as you tried to break into this. Mm-hmm. Of course, all the experience is helpful, but the three obvious things working against you, whatever prejudice existed in the movie industry toward television people,
right,
your youth,
right,
and the fact that you looked even younger,
right,
and the fact that you had this wholesome image from being Opie Taylor or Richie Cunningham or whomever else. So somebody says, how can he do anything that has artistic merit? He's a cute kid.
Or take charge of a set.
Yeah.
Well, that was, you know, you have to prove yourself. And the first producer to give me a chance. I mean, I was always talking about it, and people were, you know, kind of polite, but maybe a little patronizing about the whole idea of my directing. You know, I'm sure someday, if you really want to, it'll, you know, you'll have an opportunity, that kind of thing.
Best of luck to you, young man.
Yeah. But Roger Corman was a guy who had, you know, they kind of the king of the B movies is the label that he doesn't love that label, but that's how people know him. And he's made millions of movies. Well, I mean, practically. And he started so many people: Francis Coppola, Martin Scorsese, Jack Nicholson, Jonathan Demme, who did Silence of the Lambs. You know, a lot of people. And he had a project that called Eat My Dust that he wanted me to act in. And I read it, and I just hated it. I just thought it was just terrible. But I also knew that he was about the only person giving first-time directors a chance. And I went and I talked to him about it and showed him some of my student films and things like that, and a script that my father and I had written. And he said, well, that movie that you've written is the you know, it's quality work, but you know, I'm more interested in action movies, and that wasn't an action movie. If you'll act and Eat My Dust, I won't actually promise you all you'll direct, but I'll promise you that you can write an outline for something. And if I like the outline, you know, I'll let you direct that. So it was the closest thing to, you know, it was a little bit of progress. And Eat My Dust was a kind of a drive-in movie hit.
I got more speeding tickets than anybody else in the county.
I want to ride in that car.
They steal a super stocker and tell the world to eat my dust. Darlene is in the fast cars. Hoover is in the Darlene. When they get their hands on 700 horses, they've got to get into trouble.
What's this?
They're all about a screaming, squealing, shattering smash-a-thon. A hot date in a hot car, cruising at 150, rubber burning, and Smokey can't put it out.
Hoover, you're outrageous.
Ron Howard pops the clutch and tells the world to eat my dust.
So I went back and I said, okay. And he said, all right, write an outline. Well, I said, what kind of story do you want to do? And we started talking. I was giving him all kinds of ideas. You know, I had police thrillers and little tender, little slice of life stories and stuff like science fiction and everything. Finally, he said, Ron, when we were testing titles for Eat My Dust, Eat My Dust, of course, came in first, but another title came in a very close second, Grand Theft Auto. Come up with a storyline that we can call Grand Theft Auto, and you've got yourself a movie.
And we're back with Ron Howard. We talked about the Andy Griffith Show a little bit, just kind of peripheral mentions. Let's get right into it. The characters on this were some of the best in television. I mean, Barney Fife, Don Knotts' Barney Fife,
yeah,
you know, is close to Art Carney's Ed Norton, just as a great television character.
And great comic characters. I mean, both those examples, are right there with Buster Keaton and Charlie Chaplin, and, you know, Lucy certainly falls into the same category. Television's a great format. It's a great format, and it's a great format for comedy, particularly. The show... I don't think that show would ever get on the air today. You know, it's sort of the humor is too gentle. It really just all comes out of character. It was so much fun to be on it. It honestly was. I would literally cry when the season would end, and I was going to be away from these people for 3 or 4 months. You know, because it was a joy to go there.
Some of it was based on your relationship with your own father, right?
Well, early on, my dad, who, you know, I think is kind of nervy of him looking back on it to have done this, I'm really glad he did, suggested that the Opie-Andy relationship could be a lot different and a lot truer to reality and still as entertaining if Opie actually respected his father. If, you know, instead of being a kind of a wise-ass kid who could, you know, could come up with the one-liners and stuff, if it was a kid who cared about what his father thought and might make mistakes and have to be dealt with, mm-hmm. But Andy loved that idea. And in the early, so the evolution of the relationship, I think they looked a lot to my father as an example, and also to our relationship as an example.
Is there any particular episode or two that kind of stand out for you?
I'll tell you, there's one. The best acting episode was this one where I was called Opie the Birdman, where I had accidentally killed a bird who was nesting and wound up raising the little chicks, and it was a nice story. The one I had the most fun with was one that my father actually wrote the story for, and it was a Little League story, and it was based on a thing that my father and I had actually been through. For my birthday party, my dad invited all my friends, and we played a game. It was just sort of a pickup game in a park. My dad kind of umpired, and as luck would have it, I was up in the last inning, and bases were loaded, and I had a chance to tie the game if I hit a homer, and I nailed one right in the gap. We were running forever, and it was a close play at the plate, and my dad called me out. And I was sure I was safe. I was damn sure. I was upset about it. And I really didn't forgive him for quite a while for making that call. And he said, well, I had to make the call. Had to call it like I saw it. And my birthday, Dad. My birthday. Grand slam home run. Call it like I saw it. So I'm sorry. So my dad went in to pitch that idea, and they did an episode about that. And I thought it was just great. It was sort of the first time that I saw how you could take things from your life and actually apply it to a story.
Speaking of baseball, you've always been a baseball fan, and there was a moment of realization about how strange and blessed your life was while you were doing the Andy Griffith Show. It had to do with Koufax and Drysdale.
Oh yeah. That was kind of odd. It was sort of, you know, they held out. I think it was 65 or 66, and it was a double holdout, which pretty unheard of at that
yeah.
time. And and I was looking in the paper, and I was following the negotiations because I was desperate for them to be ready for opening day, and I hoped they'd make a deal. It was also just about the time I started paying attention to what I was earning. Never really thought about it too much until then. And I totaled it up, and once they made their deal, I compared what I was earning for a season of the Andy Griffith Show against what the two greatest pitchers in baseball were earning, and I was actually making like a little bit more, and I thought, well, now this can't be fair.
Yeah.
This business is just not fair. Now they've passed me by. I was complaining to my agent about it the other day. The ball players are so far ahead of me now.
Now you can hit .211 and yeah. make more money than a guy who directs a blockbuster
That's right.
film.
That's right.
So it's come completely
yeah.
full circle.
Yeah.
You know, the Andy Griffith reruns are obviously still on cable TV.
Right.
And you can still see the resemblance as you an adult and you as a little kid.
Right.
So do you get that Opie stuff still? And does it ever annoy you, as good-natured as you seem to be?
I think it would annoy me if I didn't have a career, you know, if I hadn't been able to grow beyond that and develop a career. Then I think it could be frustrating and embarrassing, and I certainly don't want to be thought of primarily as the kid who was on that show. You know, by the time it's all said and done, I hope people will really think of me first and foremost as a movie director. I think having been on the show, it's like the joke, you know, baseball had been very, very good to me.
Yeah.
I can't complain. You know, I mean, I think it's given me, as a director, an unusual kind of rapport with the audience. I think a lot of people pay attention to the movies as a result, maybe are rooting for me a little bit, and I'm grateful for that.
I have a few questions here that have long lingered about the Andy Griffith Show, and then we'll move on. One, how far was Mayberry from Mount Pilot? People were always going to Mount Pilot like it was Paris.
Right.
Now, Mount Pilot is where something really hot could happen,
right? I think I remember that it was, you know, it was something like 60 miles. But for anybody, you know, to actually leave Mayberry was just to get on the other side of the town line, you know,
yeah.
a pretty big deal.
And Andy didn't have, you know, obviously he was a widower and devoted to his son and to Aunt Bee.
Right.
Didn't have much romantic stuff going on until the school teacher, Helen Crump,
right.
showed up. And I always thought, with all due respect to whoever this actress was, she was a little too straight-laced
for Andy.
I wanted someone with a little more pizzazz for Andy.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. Of course, Opie loved the idea because Miss Crump was a teacher, and he kind of thought he could get a little break in the grades.
Yeah. And what did Thelma Lou see in Barney? This was a woman of great tolerance and perseverance.
You have to remember the Mayberry is a small town.
I guess a lot of people thought Happy Days came out of American Graffiti because right. they're both sort of 50s nostalgia right. things. But not so, right?
No, the pilot actually was made a year or so before American Graffiti and tested well, I guess, but didn't get on. And then I think as a result of American Graffiti, you know, it was brought off, pulled off the shelf and got its opportunity. That was fun. For a little while, we experienced a little Beatlemania. It was really, you know, we would go on a personal appearance and 20,000 people would show up and stuff. And it was an amazing time, and I made a lot of good friends that have really friendships that have lasted.
And kind of ties into some of the things we've been discussing about you being a child actor, being successful at that, already having a career as a director going that would lead to good things. And I guess that allowed you to kind of roll with the punches when a show in which you were the nominal star
right.
really was taken over by Henry Winkler as the Fonz, because he became a national phenomenon.
Oh, it was extraordinary. Well, first of all, you know, in working with Henry Winkler on that show...
A nice guy, and I guess that helps.
A great guy. And we were friends from the beginning, you know, and very different. We're very different people, much different. He has a very different background, but we always got along great, and we're friends. But also, he was so extraordinary in that role that you didn't want to see him held back.
I'm allergic to girls, Rich.
No, I... What if you're not allergic to girls, okay? Let's just look at some of the environmental factors. It could be anything. You could be allergic to corsages.
Negative. I asked the girls not to bring me any more flowers.
The ragweed up at Inspiration Point. There's a lot of ragweed.
Negative.
Up there,
I asked the girls to mow it and burn it. They did it. It's the girls.
That's just an assumption. We need scientific tests.
These lips do not touch guinea pigs.
When that shift happened, it was an adjustment for me, and I was frustrated a little bit by it, so it was not emotionally, you know, always the easiest thing in my life. But the thing that really made it work was the quality of the work and the relationships on the show. And we always thought of that show as an ensemble, and whatever was happening in terms of, you know, the perception or the way the studio was treating one person as opposed to somebody else or any of that stuff, yeah. was kind of easy to file at the door because we were there making a show that we liked and in the company of people that we loved.
Sunday, Monday, happy days. Tuesday, Wednesday, happy days. Thursday, Friday, happy days. The weekend comes, my cycle hums, ready to race for you. These days are on.
We've been enjoying the conversation so much the last couple of nights, I didn't want to abruptly shift gears, and so, never fear, we didn't talk about Backdraft and Far and Away and Splash and Cocoon and Parenthood. So, you know what we do. We'll tape another show. We will not show it tomorrow night because we're not going for the hat trick here, but sometime in the very near future, we'll talk about the feature films that Ron has directed, and in the meantime, thanks a lot for being here.
Thanks.
Okay,
you.
See you later.